budget for economic development. And it was mentioned earlier about CERN, so I made sure that when CERN came in, the money that was going to be allocated with CERN, that it went to CERN, and the funding that was supposed to be given back to the community. So that money that was coming back to the community was $2 million to the community, $6 million to the school district. That was what was allocated when that property came in and they bought up the old Bannister Mall piece. So I guess for some of you to understand that I've been busy with budget and appropriations, health and mental health and social services as a state representative and a school board member. So I just want to say that when it comes to that, you have to look at where the money's going, how much is going to come back into the community, how much that you're going to be paying out, and then also look at if where's it going to put you, if you're going to go into the red or not. And I think at this point that I'm looking at some of the things that our current mayor has done, I've been kind of pleased with that. Thank you. I didn't have my glasses on, I'm sorry.
Larissa Hayden.
Again, I'm Larissa Hayden, Alderman Ward 2, running for Alderman Ward 2. And I'm not a big fan of tax incentives or TIFs. However, I have seen some good that they've done. I would prefer to use the tax money, though, to increase or strengthen our infrastructure. I think that if we use that money for that as opposed to benefiting large businesses and corporations, which really don't need our money anyway, but I would prefer to use it in that way. However, I have seen in some instances where TIF money has been properly appropriated and helped the entire community. Thank you.
Chuck Hens. Haynes.
I see tax incentives as one of a number of things that the Board of Aldermen and the city government has in their toolkit to help with economic development and attract new business. But again, it's only one of a number of tools that we can use for economic development. The Walmart experience was brought up and does not appear to have been a very positive experience in a number of people's minds. But the tax incentives have to be carefully looked at if they are going to be considered. Must be very carefully looked at. All the positives and the negatives must be considered. And one thing that I do not want to see is any tax incentive that ends up being corporate welfare. So if we're going to use a tax incentive, it must be looked at very, very closely and analyzed completely. Thank you.
Diane Creasick.
Diane Creasick here. I am not for corporate welfare. Tax incentives can be good, but we need to be very careful. If there is development that we might want to look at, we need to look at it strongly. The city should never be in a situation where it guarantees the success of that development. The developers should put their money where their mouth is. So in this little town, we just need to be super careful that we're not taken care of. I would like to see more small business than these franchises that are buoyed up by shareholders.
Jason Green.
Jason Green, Alderman Ward 2. And I mentioned this earlier in my first statement. This is honestly one of the reasons why I ran back in 2013 for Alderman. You know, everyone brings up the Walmart deal. That's a $40 million TIF. At the end of this, it ended up costing $70 million. What a lot of people don't know is the bond payment on that in a couple years is going to end up going up. So the city could be in the rears and on the hook to pay for even more if they don't generate enough sales tax revenue within that TIF district. That's the awful type of negotiation that was going to take in place during that TIF. And it really frustrates me. It robs from your streets. It robs from your emergency services. As a teacher, it annoys me and irritates me because it robs from our children. This is something, when I got elected, that we've had, it's become an economic reality. Folks want to know, you know, like Kansas Street, like here in Kansas, here. This is a major reason why. Corporate welfare, and they do this in a lot. Walmart and other companies will do this in a lot of small towns. My undergrad in Maryville, Missouri, towns disappeared. Well, small mom-and-pop shops because of that situation. Thank you.
Janet Emerson.
Thank you. Janet Emerson, Alderman Ward 3. For the most part, I do not think, especially large corporations, should get TIFs. As other people have spoken about, the one out here on 350 Highway, I mean, $68,000 every year for 23 years is what it cost our taxpayers to have that store out there. And we get nothing. We have the police that have to go out there all the time and take care of problems that arise. But I think that small entities that are trying to get a jump start, if we can help them, that would probably be good. But that's on a business-to-business thing. You have to look at all of the things that it will contribute to this city, and that's very, very important that you do make sure that what you do is good for the citizens. Thank you.
Bill Van Busker.
Thank you. Yeah, sometimes tax incentives are needed to attract all businesses, whether large or small. We use things such as a tax, 353 tax abatement in our downtown area to assist small businesses in improving their businesses. That's something we can do. I wasn't around on the board at the time the Walmart TIF took place, so I know the intentions were good, but the economy went sour and it didn't work out too well. So right now it is costing a lot of money. Supposed to be other development around that. That didn't happen like it was supposed to. I'm sure that in cities such as, for instance, the Sutherland Lumber, at CID, which is the Community Improvement District, they charge a little bit extra tax in addition to the normal sales tax that we enjoy as a city. But they invested millions of dollars in that. They will get that back through that additional tax over a period of time. The city taxpayer didn't invest anything in that. They took all landed property and made it a good property, and it's great for a city. Those type of incentives are good for us. Thank you.
Phyllis Goforth.
Okay, Phyllis Goforth, candidate for Alderman Ward 5. I, too, straddle this issue. I think it's not a cut and dried. I think you have to look at what it's bringing to the city or what it's taking from the city. I, as a business owner, I owned a business I still own it, I've had it for 31 years, and never had a tax incentive. Resented a little bit with tax incentives, but I hadn't had one. But I also had a business for 17 years, never had any tax incentive on that. So I still think that there are cases, and I think you have to go with each one and all the statistics about it. So, thank you.
Frank Hunt.
Frank Hunt, Ward 1. Tax incentives do have their place, but we've got to make sure that it doesn't affect us so far and so long and so deep that we basically drown in the opportunities that are being afforded to those that are being given to. I think the small business person for a 30,000 size town like Raytown is right now, small business people should be looked at more than larger corporations. Complete studies and make sure that they're real, and then communicate those studies to our citizens so that we all know where we're standing when we actually get ready to move into these kinds of exercises. Thank you.
Ryan Myers.
Well, I can say that each individual circumstance needs to be looked at individually. This is kind of my bread and butter because my background is in commercial real estate. So I deal with municipalities on a daily basis that utilize TIF funds. What I can tell you is most people don't realize that the six functions of the dollar are taken into consideration when given a TIF. We're not necessarily looking at the present value of the asset. At the end of the day, we're looking at the future value. And in an upturning real estate cycle, this will actually exceed the present value. So in some circumstances, this can bode well for a municipality, if they have the right, if they have the right funds, if they have the right budgetary needs or capabilities. But I'll go back and say that I think it needs to be on an individual basis.
Thank you. Our next question. Enforcing codes in our city is important. What is your strategy or strategies encouraging residents to follow these codes to increase or maintain the value of our property? And the first responder will be Diane Creasy. Do you like to hear the question again?
Yeah, go ahead and repeat it.
Enforcing codes in our city is important. What is your strategy or strategies encouraging residents to follow these codes to increase or maintain the value of their property?
Okay. Diane Creasy, Ward 5. First thing is, you gotta get everybody's story. What is the story? We don't know who's living in those homes, what's going on. I'm finding, as I knock on doors, a lot of these distressed properties as our seniors hanging on by their fingernails. So, what we need to do, I'd like to see programs to help those. That will help that situation. As far as other code enforcement, we just need to give people the benefit, work with them, show them they're more amiable if, you know, we want to work with them and not be like, you know, police them. And that will, I think, help a lot and help them to increase pride in their town and thank them. And I think that will help. A positive attitude towards that will help.
Jason Green.
Jason Green, Alderman Ward 2. The board actually recently passed legislation last year with a partnership with Habitat for Humanity. And what that does is they provide the labor to help out with an existing issue at home. Maybe you have an elderly individual who's unable to do it themselves, to fix an issue themselves, or maybe there's a fixed income situation. And what it also does is Habitat, they provide a lot of the labor, which is obviously the largest cost of that. And in addition, they have access to small little microloans to take care and get the materials necessary to upgrade their home to be more compliant with codes. Also, in addition to that, I think expanding the community cleanup day, which is something we've made strides for, and it's taking place this year, actually, to give folks a better opportunity. You know, a lot of the communities, they have community cleanup days that are more expansive than us, places where you can take trash or, you know, take, you know, large waste, and we're going to be doing that to help out folks be compliant.
Frank Hunt.
Frank Hunt, Ward 1. I have personally been working on this individual code enforcement type situation in my own neighborhood. You don't get very far too quick, but you do have to continue to move forward to make things happen. This year we're going to get together as a community, and we're going to ask a trucking company like Briggs or someone similar to that to come by and pick up at the doorway. So the actual expense and the execution of all of it that we want to have done as far as cleanup and making things look a whole lot better is going to happen because we, the community, are pulling together to make these kinds of things happen. And I want to make sure that we communicate very effectively before we start that program, because people are going to feel like that they're being personally pointed out if we don't make sure that we have a cooperation between both parties.
Greg Walters.
Greg Walters, running for Alderman in Ward 1. Personally, I think the question had to do with how do we make enforcement
more strategies to improve enforcement of codes.
I think it's all well and good to help those that are in need, and I think we should. I think just as important is the other end of that stick, and that is that your codes department has to be fair-minded and has to be able to be even-handed in how it does. You cannot crack down on one problem in one area of town and walk by it and not see, and act like you don't see it in the next area of town. I think that's a problem that's being addressed at City Hall now, and I'd like to see the culture change a little bit there to where we have an aggressive situation where people will understand that if you're going to live in Raytown, you're going to keep your property up, you're going to take good care of your stuff.
Ryan Myers.
Honestly, I don't think this is something that I can use an alderman or codes enforcement can take care of. I think this is something that us as a community can take care of. When I was a child, I was taught to lead by example. My next door neighbor unfortunately passed away several years ago. No one's in the house. Upkeep hasn't been the best on it, so I've been proactive in doing it myself. I learned that from my grandfather, who's 85 years old, and he still climbs up on his neighbor's house to blow out the leaves out of the gutters. I believe that Raytown is a community that cares, and I believe that together we can work on codes enforcement by helping others. If it gets to the point where they're unwilling to keep up with codes enforcement after we help, I think that codes needs to step in and take care of it to help keep our property values up.
Janet Emerson.
Thank you. Janet Emerson, Ward 3. When you look at the ordinances that have been in place before, if you get a citation, it can take up to 2 years for anything to be done, and sometimes longer. Recently, the board did pass an ordinance that's going to cut that time down, and especially when you have all of these out-of-town owners that do not want to take care of those problems are going to be taken care of. It's one of those things that I have worked very hard with the people in my ward that they've called with problems. I have taken care of them. I'm very proud of that. That's one of the things I ran on 3 years ago. And I believe that when we work with people, that they understand that it's important to keep their property up. And I think we're getting to the place where that's happening. And I look forward to our city being all cleaned up. Thank you.
Chuck Haynes,
candidate for Alderman Ward 4. Code enforcement is something that we all need to be aware of. There are appear to be a growing number of rentals in the city of Raytown, so we need to make sure that these are kept up, not only by the people who are living there, but the owners also. Another thing that I'm hearing when I'm walking the neighborhoods is the way we deal with the code enforcement themselves. We need to be more personable, get out of the car and talk to the people instead of just sending them a letter. And then, of course, if there are some issues, we'll be able to discuss that and find that out at that conversation. Is there going to be some need for labor? Is there going to need for other financial assistance? And another thing that I hear quite often is that there are properties that have been vacant for some time for whatever reason, but the banks own these properties. And the properties are being allowed to deteriorate, and the yards are being overgrown, and nothing's being done to take care of these properties. And I think the codes need to be enforced on the banks also, especially on their properties. Thank you.
Bonnie Mims.
Bonnie Mims, candidate for Ward 5. And I guess what I'm going to say is because I have served on a committee that handled Property Maintenance Appeals Board for many years. The first thing is to educate your people and to be able to communicate to them, to let them know the do's and don'ts. And so I do walk through my own neighborhood, and I live in part of the older part of Raytown. And the second thing that I have that we need to do is the piece where you talk about the landlords is holding them responsible, letting them know what the codes are, and then their fines that should be enforced, and that way they will take care of their properties. The third one is to find out at first, before we go anywhere, is if we have properly staffed in code enforcement to see if they can handle what's being done. But we also need to make our parent people aware what incentive programs are out there, what's available for them, so that they can build pride back up into their neighborhoods. Those are the important things that I think that we need to do. We need to get up, get out there, and find out what's really happening, and still only going out when it's election time. Thank you.
Phyllis Goforth.
Phyllis Goforth, Alderman Ward 5, Canada. One of my things, and so I'm going to reiterate on this that's been said, is education. We have code committees, code staff,